Welcome to Planet Comic Con. Everybody doing okay so far? Welcome to the Direct from DC panel. I would like to introduce our guest at the moment. You know him as the writer of Batman, Talon, Swamp Thing, and the upcoming Superman Unchained, Mr. Scott Snyder. As you know, Ethan has canceled his appearance, and Brian is somewhere wandering the floor. Hopefully he will be showing up pretty soon. In his absence, I would like to introduce the editor at Vertigo Comics. Actually, that's going to be Mark Doyle. So we will be opening up for a lot of Q&A. We've got a mic down here, so if anybody wants to go ahead and get in line as far as for the upcoming Q&A, we're going to do a couple of questions first, just to break the ice. First off, we want to discuss with New 52. Anybody who's not familiar with New 52, it's about a year and a half old now. Basically, DC Comics, the entire universe, was shuttered and then rebuilt from the ground up. And one of the architects of that is certainly Scott Snyder with Batman and several of his other titles. First question is going to be, what were your initial impressions in regard to first hearing about the New 52 project?
I was terrified. First, though, thank you guys so much for having me. I really appreciate it. I've been looking forward to coming to this con forever. I go to some that are, you know, the big, big ones, and where DC is, and, you know, it's just, they're fun, but it's also just a lot of, you know, having to do interviews and that kind of stuff, and it's really nice to get to go to a con where I get to actually meet you guys, so I hope you come by and say hi at some point. It's a highlight, definitely. So thanks. Yeah, the 52, what happened was I was working on Detective, I'm just going to get Fireside Chat, it's only me, up here, Brian's up here, he's tough, but anyway, I was working on Detective, and I finished an arc called Black Mirror, and I was thinking about doing another story with Dick Grayson, and James Jr., and then I actually had a story in mind for Bruce. And they told me they'd like the movie over to Batman, and that, you know, I knew Jock and Francesco couldn't work with me at that point, so I was really nervous. I was like, oh god, I'm gonna start on Batman 790, whatever. I don't know how I'm gonna do that, I'm so scared, you know, and my wife was like, oh, you gotta calm down, and I was just like, you know, I was calling sick. And then they paired me with Greg Capullo, which was awesome. You know, it was not awesome at all, actually, at first, where we totally didn't get along. I don't know if I told this story, you've heard it, but. He was used to working from outline for Haunt and that kind of stuff, and I was used to working, like, you know, full script. And so he was sort of like, oh, I'm worried that the story's going to get in the way of the art. And I was like, I'm worried the damn art's going to get in the way of the story. We're not getting along at all. We actually, like, I remember calling up Bob Harris and being like, one of us might have to leave Gotham, man. One of us might have to leave. And then he was just like, you know, why don't you get on the phone and talk to him about the story and see his designs? And I did. And we just started getting along like gangbusters, and now he literally is one of my best friends. Where we pick contests to go together, so that we get to hang out. So I'm going to Dublin where he's going. We're going to Chicago Wizard World because we're going together with our wives. And so he really has become like more than just a partner on that book. And he loves you guys. I mean, he loves Gotham. I'm saying, you know, he has the opportunity to go anywhere and do anything. I mean, obviously Marvel would love to have him. You know, and. You know, he's been on any book he wants, but he just signed up really to stay on Batman for another, you know, 20 plus issues, you know, if he wants. So he really wanted to say, you know, he wanted me to say for him how much he appreciates the support. It really means the world to him. He really loves you guys and loves Gotham. So I was with him, and then I got the call from Dan where he was like, in the deal, where he was like, and we got big news, it's going to be Batman number one. I was just like, there's no way I can do this, I can't do it. Terrified, he knows. I call him up. And like, I was just like, I can't be Batman number one. That's too much pressure. But at the end of the day, I guess what happened was I really loved the story, the Court of Owls story, and I figured it was what I was going to do anyway if I was going to do Batman 700 and whatever. So I was going to do that and make it a tiny bit more user-friendly by having, I think I changed like one or two panels where it's like, and when my parents were killed in that alley, you know, so you know that's his history, if you've never read Batman. But other than that, the story I set out to do from the beginning, hey, what's up? It was a lot of fun, man. So it was like, I got to do the story that I was going to do anyway, so I tried to just block out a lot of the fanfare and 52 and that stuff, and just sort of stick to the stories that, you know, you love, and not worry too much about the idea of the 52 idea.
You may have noticed we had someone else enter the room. You know him as the writer of Wonder Woman, as well as the upcoming Brother Lona miniseries that returns to the world of 100 Bullets, Mr. Brian Azzaro. I'll pose the same question to you. What were your initial thoughts in regard to the New 52 program?
That was the stupidest idea.
Don't feel that way?
No.
Okay. We're going to go back to Scott for a second. Scott, you said that you didn't plan really an origin story when you were starting out Batman, but we're going to get that origin story coming up pretty soon. Yes. Did you want to tell us about some Zero Year?
Yeah, sure. I'm really, really excited about it. I mean, I'm crazy nervous about it as a marker, I can tell you. But the way it came about was that a little while ago, like maybe 6 months ago, I came up with a story that would take place during Bruce's early years that would show them in a really, really different way with an event or something happening in Gotham that would sort of reshape the context of those years in a way that I thought would be really different. And I got really geared up to tell it, and DC approached and said, are you interested in doing Batman's origin, Dan and those guys, because he's one of the only superheroes who haven't shown sort of anything about his past, given the sort of relaunch of the 52. Like Action, you know, retold Superman's early years, and a lot of the other superheroes have had their origins explored, told in different ways or some ways similar to the core, but Batman was sort of steered clear of that, except for that Zero issue, and the Zero issue really gave you a window into something pretty different, where Bruce had set up shop in Crime Alley, and not at the Manor, and was facing off with the Red Hood gang, and his uncle, Philip Kane, who's in continuity, you know, was sort of running Wayne Enterprises. So that moment when I realized there was a chance to do the origin, I was like, well, what I'm going to do is sort of put in as much of year one as I can and sort of save the pieces that are there from the origin. But little by little, I guess what I realized was that we've all done stories, even though we were pretty adamant about trying to protect Batman's history and make it so that those things had happened. All of us have done stories that have changed those origins. So Selina Kyle has a different origin than she has in year one, clearly. Jim Gordon has a different origin. The Falcone gang has a different origin. James Jr. would be 6 years old if, you know, the New 52 tracked with, you know, the continuity from before. And so it became sillier and sillier as I was looking at it to show scenes from year one and try and do it. And also what I realized was that if I show you scenes from year one, I'm just doing a shittier version of year one, honestly, at the end of the day. Because I could never touch the hem of that book in general, but when I'm showing you that just as a reclamation act, it just seems stale and boring. So what I realized was instead, we might not be able to do anything that comes close to something like year one, but why not do the origin in a way that you've never seen? So what Zero Year really is, it keeps the core material there, his parents are still killed in the alley with Joe Chill and the absolute core stuff, but it's designed to be a story where you open it up and every page from page one, hopefully you'll say, I've never seen anything like this when it comes to Batman's origin, and I hope you love it as much as we do. I mean, the opening four pages are like my favorite four pages we've done on Batman ever. So I'm really hoping you'll open it and just be like, no, it's not year one at all. It's crazy different in its tone. It's meant to be a little bit more kind of punk rock and out there and bombastic and fun, but it is meant to also be very true to the core, and it has all of the stuff, the layers and the kind of, hopefully the richness and stuff that you would expect from an origin story. But that's, I guess that's my pitch for it to you guys. And
that's,
I can tell you,
pitch.
Thanks. I can tell you honestly, it really is my favorite stuff that we've done on it. Like on my kids, I mean it. It really is like my favorite story. So I'm nervous about it. I know it's risky and all that stuff, but I feel like I said when I got on Batman, if I ran out of stories that I was going to do that were my favorites, or if I started to do stories that were like playing it safe for us, where we're just doing a little bit of a, you know,
and the Calendar Man story because it's easy or because that stuff, that I'd rather move over and let somebody else write the book at this point because I know there's a lot of people out there that would kill to write the book. So I feel like we're going to try and take a risk and do something that hopefully you guys will find as special as we do.
I don't think there's going to be a problem with that. So conversely, Brian, you gave us a new origin pretty early in the Wonder Woman run. Would you like to talk about how you came up with that?
We already know it.
Did we give you a new origin?
Well, as far as the change, as far as Diana not being made of clay.
Oh, that. Well, that's not really a new origin. That's just a different way of looking at the original origin.
Okay.
We added another layer, you know.
All right, certainly.
And that all came out of a conversation that I had had with, again, Dan DiDio.
This was over dinner?
It was over dinner.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Wonder Woman wasn't necessarily what you were angling
to
write.
You want to tell the story?
No. I'll give you the time. Sorry.
Okay. I wasn't going to be doing Wonder Woman at all. We'd been in discussion with another character. Dan had been trying to get me to go down to the DCU for a while on a regular book. And we were actually pretty settled on what was going to happen with this character. And this was prior to the New 52. It was even... A horrible idea in Dan's head. And he told me what the plans were for Wonder Woman, and I was just shocked that they were going to do something like this to that character that I thought fundamentally was going to hurt her in some way. And I said, maybe this is a different kind of approach you might want to take. I think it can actually strengthen the character a little bit and open things up, make her unique in the DCU. And by the end of the dinner, I'm writing Wonder Woman. And I don't know if what Dan said was real or not. He might have just, conned me, you know? It's like he gave me this horrible pitch, and I'm like, oh, my God, you know?
We'll have to ask him that.
What, Dan?
Yeah, we'll have to ask him as far as maybe we can end the show next
year.
We'll ask him whether or not there was a con job. I think it worked out well.
He probably won't remember. Dan doesn't remember things.
Okay, all right. As far as the way that both of you have written your major titles in regard to Wonder Woman and Batman, we've seen a lot more crossovers in Batman, most likely because there's simply the Bat family, so there are all these different titles, whereas you haven't had those crossovers. Can you talk about as far as the different processes that are involved in that?
Yeah, I mean, for me, the crossovers just kind of came, and in Swamp Thing, too, just came organically out of making a story that I knew would involve those characters. I knew, you know, Gotham was going to be attacked in a big way in Court of Owls, and then the Joker was coming for the family in the Joker story. So it became more about, do I want to write those characters into my book and then just tell the other writers how I'm going to use them, or would I sort of accept that, A, they're going to write the characters better than I could anyway, and B, it would make for a better story if it gives them the room to play with the toys that are in Batman in a way that doesn't interfere with what they have coming. So all the stuff we did in Batman was optional. I mean, you see like Batwoman, for example, J.H. decided, and I think rightly decided that he wanted to keep that book separate. Detective was kept separate at first too and stuff like that. So there was never something where it was like DC saying you should do a crossover. It was just that the story in Batman became something that would touch the lives of those other characters, and then I went to Mike Martz and to Dan and said, if you want to offer it to the other books and say, do you guys want to play along for an issue or not? It's up to you. And it's been great. I mean, we are honestly pretty close in that group. I mean, Pete Tomasi, is a good friend, and Kyle Higgins and those guys and Gail. So, it's been a lot of fun working with them and seeing them take the sort of pieces that we're putting and developing in Batman and then running with them and making those stories their own. So. It hasn't really been something where I've been not much more, I think, than kind of a moderator and making sure, honestly, that like the Talons act the way they're supposed to, or the Joker acts the way he's supposed to, and not really saying this is what should happen in your story or anything like that. So, but that's one of the other reasons that we're doing Zero Year, honestly, this year, is because it does get a lot. It gets to be a lot, like, tying into the other books and coordinating all of it. So I wanted to do a story that was really singular, kind of like the Black Mirror, where we could just dive in and not deal with some of the stuff happening in the DCU in general, and just do a book that was just our, you know, Batman sort of story without any sort of need to play along with the other books for a little bit and just do something solo.
Well, you know, I got together with all the other Wonder Woman family writers and there's nothing to cross over with.
Right. I mean,
and we were more concerned with establishing a world for her, you know, separate from what's been going on in the DCU. I mean, I think that's a problem with that character. You know, she's, you know, arguably she's one of the bigger characters in DC, but nobody knows anything about her, and there's nothing sort of really unique about that character. And we wanted to establish that, you know, just in her title. You want to read about Wonder Woman, come to her title. This is, you know, where it's all taking place. At the same time, she's been crossed over in other, in you know, other people's books, which I got no problem with. You know, I don't own that character.
Are you planning on continuing with a separate storyline? As far as, are we going to, how are you going to move forward? As far as,
what do you mean? You mean you want Superman and Wonder Woman?
No, I'm just looking as far as where you're going. No, I have no issues with where you've gone with the book. I think the book is great.
Cool.
But as far as, I'm just wondering where you're going next.
Where we're going?
Yeah.
New Genesis.
All right.
And you know what? Cut it with those, with that applause stuff for the New Gods, you know? It's crazy. You guys are like, oh, everybody gets so excited when, you know, the New Gods, the New Gods. We put out a New Gods book, it gets canceled. Nobody buys it. So this time, if we do it, buy it.
Right. Do we have some questions lined up over here?
Okay, Scott, my name is Jacob. And so Batman has been hit by two big blows this past year from Joker and Talia, the death of his family and death, and a literal death of his son. Have you talked to Jeff on how Batman's motives will be for the upcoming Trinity War? Why or why not?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we coordinate on all that stuff. I mean, in terms of how Batman is going to be used in the general DCU and also among the Bat writers. So, you know, there's nothing that's going to happen in that stuff that we don't know about, or at some point, you know, before, where we can kind of play along or sort of steer things a different way or all of that stuff. So I don't want to give anything away about what's going to happen, but the repercussions from Damian's death and also what Joker did are meant to play out over many, many, many issues, both. I mean, there's things that are going to come in Batman way down the line that will build off those, and I know there are things coming up immediately in Inc. and also in the other books like Batman and Robin.
Thanks. Next up?
Mr. Snyder, what's the deal with the Kings and the Waynes and Mr. Azzarello? Are the Amazons going to come back?
Well, the Kings and the Waynes, we're going to explore that a lot, actually, in Zero Year. So you're going to learn a lot about Martha's history and the Kane side of the family. And her brother, Philip, is a major character in the storyline itself. So you'll learn more about the history of the two industries as well, Kane Chemical and Wayne Enterprises and all of that. And how they came up together and sort of the family tensions and all that stuff about Gotham being shaped.
Eventually.
Go ahead.
All right. Now that Grant Morrison's gone from Batman, who, or are you all going to make a group decision on who's going to be the new Robin? All the Bat writers? Or is it going to be you, since you're the new guy?
No, it's not me. It's not me. You guys gave me.
You heard it here first. Scott Snyder is the new Robin.
I always feel like you guys, or people think that I have a lot more sway on that stuff than I do, or want more sway on it than I do. I mean, for me, I mean, Pete and Patrick on Batman and Robin, they really own that territory emotionally and psychologically, and that book is literally one of my favorite books to read every month. And if you're not reading it, you have to pick up Batman and Robin. It's just one of the best books around. And so it's definitely a decision we all make together, but for me, I think I am more excited to sort of see how it plays out in terms of their thinking and just sort of support them than, you know, there's no way that I would sort of try and involve myself and make a decision and pass it to a book that's been dealing with that relationship for 2 years. Do you know what I mean? So I'm really just excited to be a part of the discussion with them and figure it out as a group.
Thanks. Next.
Hi. I'm just starting into comic books with the New 52, so it's been really great for me to kind of be able to jump in and check out this whole new universe. And Mr. Azarello, your Wonder Woman title was recommended to me, and I've really enjoyed it. I've never read anything Wonder Woman before, and I've become a really big fan and caught back up on other things.
I can't hear a word you're saying.
Sorry. Is this way on?
He said you changed his life.
Changed my life. No, I really enjoyed
it. I'm sorry.
I really enjoyed it. It's nice being able to jump on and get into these guys and explore your guys' work and your past work. Sorry, I've gone on to that. What I'd like to ask you guys about is, with the New 52 being able to create new backstories or new villains like everybody else, I really like the Batman, the annual. I gave a new twist kind of to Mr. Freeze. His villain's making more of a less sympathetic villain. If you guys could talk about how you, I guess, take different spins on your character, how that's new or hard. Or,
yeah, he's asking if we're going to do like new spins on favorite villains and stuff like that.
I don't know. You got a favorite villain?
Favorite villain?
Who?
He's giving you a shot here.
Yeah.
You might want to take it.
No, I just meant like how do you guys interpret? How do you choose to make Mr. Freeze's?
Maybe some of the process in regard to
altering
these characters.
Yeah.
Go from what's already been established to giving it a new twist and making it new and exciting, I guess.
Well, it's hard. That story actually is one of the few I still kind of waver on. I love that story to death, but I think at the time, I think sometimes it becomes really exciting to have the chance to revamp villains and to do things with them that in your sort of fan fiction in your mind you think should happen to them. And for us, I mean, we tried to balance that. I mean, there are things coming up with villains. I've said a lot, I'm doing a big Riddler story, you know, coming up. You're going to see more of the Rogues, you know, in the next couple issues as well. And we don't want to show, like, you are going to see twists to them. I mean, in issue 19, coming out next week, you're going to see a twist on a villain. Because I feel like in some ways, not that we should change them, and some of them are the same, but if you have an idea for them that honors, you know, the way they were, but provides new story somehow. I mean, that was the idea with Mr. Freeze, was that the stuff with Nora had been done so well in the animated series, and they wanted Mr. Freeze reintroduced, and it just became, I didn't want to retread that story or just go back to that same well. And so it became about creating a version of the character that would have that material that you love about Nora, but would give you an extra angle of obsession and a kind of darker sense of obsession that I could play with in terms of his relationship to Batman. It's basically a version that I knew I had more stories for. So that's kind of the way that I'm approaching, you know, the Riddler and other characters coming up too.
Our approach was to ignore the Wonder Woman villains, and it sounds bad, but it's not meant to be. I mean, it was just like she needed some more. She needed a, you know, a rogues gallery. So we decided to create one. You know, and you know, we went to Olympus to do that, and I think that once you see how this story arc with the firstborn is going to play out, I think we're creating a pretty worthy adversary for her.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thanks. Next up.
Hi there. I have a question for each of you, if that's all right. Everyone's been asking about Batman. I'm really interested in Superman Unchained. I'm really looking forward to that. I'm wondering how you're approaching the character emotionally. You know, like, is it a more emotional, heartfelt type, or is it more like angered and fierce type? I'm just not sure where that's going.
Oh, he's just gonna cut his face off in the first issue and strap it to his head.
Like, TM uses laser vision. How's that happen?
Yeah, you'll have to read it. It's the fold out. No, that's a good question. I mean, I wasn't planning on doing Superman, and I had a story in my mind, and when Dan, I went out to lunch with Dan, and he was saying, asking me about other characters I'd like to use and other possibilities of books like Superman, Batman, and that stuff. And I mentioned that I had a Superman story, and it sort of rolled out from there. I assumed that those books were really full, and then they were talking about wanting to start a new title because of the 75th anniversary of the character. And so my approach with it is sort of the same way I try and approach Batman, where I try and get into the character emotionally in terms of where he is sort of in his life at that point. Like for me, Joker, you know, that storyline really is about Batman having accumulated this family and being responsible for them, and it was conceived by, you know, when I came up with it, it was when we were having our second kid, and it's very much about that feeling of wanting to not have to worry about your kids for a little bit and just wish that, you know, you could just take some refuge from that for a moment, you know, and stop being afraid of the world for them. And then thinking, well, what if a villain, and what other villain than the Joker, would hear that thought and say, I just heard you, I'll make that come true. I heard you say you wish your whole family was dead so you didn't have to worry about them anymore. And you say, no, I didn't, that's not what I thought. And he said, of course it is. It's the extension of the thing that you were really thinking and really want deep down. So with Superman, I've tried to do the same thing and examine where he is in his life. And it's in continuity. But it's really about, for me, in a lot of ways, sort of how difficult it is to do the right thing. He's already isolated by not working at the planet and stuff like that, in his relationship with Lois and what's going on a bit in Justice League as well. And so in that way, I wanted to sort of examine, I guess, what it's like to make the right decision sort of on the stage, on a global stage, when everyone would make the other decision, and how that moral compass he has is sort of what makes him great, even beyond his sort of skill set, and the thing that also kind of binds him in some ways to Lois, I guess, as a kindred spirit. Seeing her always go for the truth and always sort of, you know, risk death and risk, you know, everything to go after a story that she believes in, and the bond between those characters. So there's a new villain in it. The backups are by Dustin Nguyen, which I'm really excited about. It's going to have the whole cast. I mean, you'll see, obviously, Lois has a big part in the story, Jimmy and Perry and Lex also. And yeah, it's sort of the Superman story that I would do if I got one chance to write the character. Well, that is that story. It's my one chance to write the character. So I guess that's as much as I can say about it.
Okay.
Sure.
And then for Brian, I'm just curious how it came about that Ares is you.
Cliff's a real funny guy. That's really how it came about.
Thank you. Next.
How y'all doing today? Mr. Azzarello.
Yes.
I was wondering, how did you take the news and how have you taken the backlash of some people from you writing the Rorschach and the comedian new Before Watchmen's?
How do I take it?
Yeah, like how do you, because
like
I know.
Like a man.
Before, cause I know a lot, before they came out, there was a lot of ridicule, and why are you guys doing this, blah, 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 all this, and I was like, just give it a chance, and it's turned out, you know, really good, all the books.
Well, thanks. I knew there was going to be, you know, some backlash. I knew people were going to reject it, you know, hands down without even looking at it, but it didn't stop Lee and I, or JG for that matter, from taking the project on. You know, we thought we could tell some stories, which is what we ended up doing.
Thank you.
And the world didn't end. Just like in the original story.
Go ahead. This is a question I'd like to hear both of your takes on. When you're writing a topic or a character like Batman or Wonder Woman, there's a lot more editorial oversight since it's the character's owned by a company, they have certain interests in it, and they're part of a larger universe. How does that increase editorial interaction? How does that affect you? I mean, how do you deal with that? Sort of, how's the sausage made to a certain extent?
Do you want to answer
that? Well, you know, I don't know. If you know what you're doing, you really don't have any sort of editorial interference because you kind of know the constraints that are on the character to begin with, you know?
It's yeah.
There's things you can do and there's things you can't do, and you just know that. But in between, there's tons and tons of room, you know. With Wonder Woman, we were told just, you know, make sure it doesn't get canceled.
Yeah, I mean, For us on Batman, they've been generous to us about letting us do the stories that we want. I mean, they let us like bring back, you know, Jim Gordon's son is a total psycho, and then bring back a possible brother for Bruce. And yeah, now
you haven't done anything so outlandish.
Yeah.
That, you know.
That's what I mean. And yeah, but
it's, just, it's have respect for this stuff.
Yeah, as long as you go into it with a respect for the core. They're pretty elastic about what they'll let you do, you know. Yeah.
There's not a lot of no's if you know what you're doing.
That's good to hear. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
When you guys are writing your stories, do you know how it's going to progress beginning to end, or as you're writing them, do you sometimes realize that changing it slightly or dramatically would make it a heck of a lot better story? And once you get into it, how far can you go before you realize it's too late? I can't make that change.
Well, that sounds awful. Like, yeah. Getting to the end and realizing it's too late. For me, I mean, I have friends who, they can't really write the story if they know where it's going at the end because it's too boring for them. But for me, I really need to know. I just need to know the end and what it means to me personally, like what it's about, you know? And the ending for me really is the anchor for that. Like, and sometimes the ending changes a bit, but I mean the general direction of what needs to happen at the end to make it mean what I want it to mean to me personally, or what it's about for the characters emotionally, psychologically. And where I really do a lot of exploring is in the middle. So for example, like I know the end of Superman Unchained, our first arc, really well, and I know what has to happen and all that kind of stuff. And I know the first big beats along the way and little things in the middle, but I'm in the middle now, and that's where I really have fun exploring and seeing, okay, well, I'm gonna do a little bit with this character I didn't expect, or, you know, do a subplot about this. And so I guess that's my process.
Well, I guess I was thinking more along the lines of the art. Is the story done way before the art gets done, or?
Yeah, I mean, well, it depends how far ahead you write. I mean, for everybody's different. Like, you know, there are times where I've been way ahead of Greg on Batman, and then times where I'm like only an issue ahead of Greg on Batman. And, you know, for the most part, we stay a few months ahead, you know? So, I mean, I'm working on issue, I guess, 23, 24 right now, and he's about to start drawing issue 21. So there's the time, you know.
Okay, yeah. Thanks.
Scott, this is for you. Brian, I just have a lot of respect for you. You don't talk very long, so I'm not going to ask you anything real quick, but a lot of respect. Scott, my big thing right now is I've always been a fan of villains. The most recent Freeze really, I mean, was awesome. Was
Thanks.
Great. We had actually started a book we were going to title about that. I'm a freelance writer for sports, and we started doing some comic stuff. I even have some art on my phone, and your Freeze was almost identical to ours, and it killed me because we started this before.
Sorry.
52.
No, you're start, not.
I mean, you're Scott Snyder. It's cool. my question is, like, is there any part of you that wants to see just that villain book where it's not about Batman, it's not about Superman, it's about Freeze? It's
sure.
You know, it's a serial like that. Like, I hate to bring up a movie, but Michael Shannon as Zod in the new Man of Steel is, I think, killer. I'm bringing up villains all the time. I guess I'm just a bad guy. I don't know. But
yeah.
What villain other than Freeze would you really like to just flesh out?
There are not that many that I wouldn't. I mean, like I said, we're doing a big, you know, story with the Riddler, and I don't want to say who's coming up in different ways because I don't want to give it away, but you're going to see a lot about the Rogues in the next year, both in our book and other ones. But
well, I'd like to request one if I can.
Sure, sure.
Killer Croc.
Killer Croc, I actually wanted to do something with Killer Croc, but he's being handled in a big way over in Batwoman.
Right.
So if you go over there, they're exploring his origin through Medusa and all that kind of stuff over there. So his story's being told in that one.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
You've mentioned the Riddler a couple of times. Are we expecting that before Year Zero, during, after?
Okay. I don't know. You'll have to see.
Okay. That was a question I was asked. So, next.
This is for Mr. Azzarello, but do you plan on tampering more with the Wonder Woman origin as you did with her being, like, not made out of clay?
Why? Are you going to return and tell more about the origin?
Oh, we're going to tell more origin?
Changing more about the origin.
Yes. Tampering with the origin? Yes.
Could you specify in what way?
No.
no.
I'll give you one more.
We're going to get into why she left the island in the first place. Okay. But I'm not going to tell you that now.
Does that give you something to look forward to?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
All right, this one's for Scott. After I finished reading The Black Mirror, I was very, very interested to see what your take on a Nightwing book might be.
Yeah, I loved writing Dick Grayson. I'd love to write him again. I mean, he's definitely like the character that if I had another arm or a clone, I would write right now, because I do adore him. So maybe someday, you know, I hope to write him again sometime. But I really also, you know, I'd give a plug to what's going on in that book now, and I know Kyle's really working hard to make it something good, so.
Well, hopefully whenever you're done with Batman, they decide to stick you on Nightwing. I'd love to see that.
All right, thanks.
I'm a law student, and I'm on the competition team for a lot of trials, and one of the goals that we do when we're in trial is about telling a story. We learn a lot of different story elements, and actually our professor a couple times has alluded to Batman as a good way to define characters and to set apart villains and heroes. But I'm wondering, from your perspective, are there any sort of trade secret or favorite elements of storytelling or storytelling tools that the two of you like to employ often that are maybe more subtle or something that's not quite so obvious?
Do you want to take that one? What was that? But that's why they're secrets. I don't know. My approach to character is like fundamentally, it's about what they don't say rather than what they say. So, you know, that's what I always. My characters, to me anyway, have a very robust internal life. You don't get to see that. So what they do, it is my secret. But that seems like something that you would, as a, you know, in trials, people are lying all the time, you know. So even though they swear to tell the whole truth, they're lying, and that's part of, you know, that's an inner life right there.
Scott,
me,
same thing.
Yeah, I mean,
Scott's gonna give you all his secrets. Yeah.
No, it's hard to talk about how you go through characterization. I mean, for me, I try and figure out what the characters, at least for that arc, what the big fear is that they have that's going to happen. Meaning, like, I try and do it so that the story is about that character facing something they don't want to face about themselves. I mean, for me, my favorite villains are monsters. You know, classic monsters, the monsters in just, you know, horror movies in general are the ones that kind of make you more afraid of yourself than they do of them in some way. So with Joker, it's about him saying, deep down, you really want all these people dead, and you just don't want to admit it. Or with Court of Owls, it's about them saying, you know, you think you know the city, but you really don't know it at all, and all your confidence is built on a false foundation. And with Zero Year, it's similar. There's something that it's about that Bruce doesn't want to face in a big way. So I try and do that, and then really punish the character, I guess, by sort of building a story that's going to come at them worse and worse and worse to try and prove this thing is true, like a trial by fire about them in some way, until they really have to look at it and say whether it is. And sometimes it is true about them, and sometimes it's not, I guess.
Thanks. Next.
Howdy, fellas. Chip Reese, editor at StashMyComics.com. Scott, I know you to be a super fan before you became a creator. How does that impact what you write, for instance, with year zero, how that, you know, taking into account year one, or zero year, sorry.
Well, you have to kind of have two brains, I guess, with it. I mean, imagine, maybe it's the same with you, Brian, but like, you have a love for the characters that you have to almost keep separate in that way, as a fan, you know, or what you think the fan in you right now, if you were reading it, would want or think, versus what you want as the writer and a fan of the character. So for me, I try and imagine, I guess, that you guys want, well, let me back up. Like, the way I do it is this. Like, I teach a class right now, which I have no business teaching anymore because I have, like, no time to do it at all, which I apologize to my students, but I'm like, I really have, I try my best. But anyway, the reason I do it is because it's fun for me because the golden rule of the class, and it sounds really corny, but it's true, and I've done it when I was doing fiction. I taught this too when I had no reason to teach it, is that you can only hand in the story that you would like to read the most. And so I get comics in this class that are like, some of them are just humor, some of them are political, some of them are really deep and disturbing memoir stuff. But the bravery of the students bringing stuff in like that and handing it in front of people they barely know, it makes you go home and think to yourself, well, I'm on characters that, you know, mean the world to a ton of people, but I have to do the same thing and write the story that I'm gonna, would like to pick up and read no matter what. Even if that story might be upsetting, even if that story might be something that will be risky. And, you know, I've tried to take my cue from guys that I admire that way and, you know, and to just do the stories that I'd like to pick up and read and hope that in the DNA of those stories is the same stuff that you love about the characters and that you'll follow us there, you know, I guess. It's the best way I can answer that without sort of thinking about how many people love Batman and then freaking out about it again.
Thank you. Brian, you mentioned developing Wonder Woman's Rogues Gallery. Was that something that you came in with a mission to do, or were you approached to go to come on to Wonder Woman?
No, I wasn't approached to come on Wonder Woman. But when we started talking about it, and I started looking at her villains, and, you know, other than Egg Foo, none of them really interested me. And rather than try and reinvent them and make them something that interested me, I wanted to just do something brand new. You know, let's create some new villains, kind of flesh her out. You know, maybe we can come up with some characters that are going to stick in her world and that can be used outside of it.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right, let me see if I can address this a little shorter than the other people. Okay. So I actually have a question about Vertigo. It's been one of my favorite lines since I was first introduced to Sandman. So ever since Sandman,
all I heard was Vertigo.
It's been one of my favorite lines ever since I was first introduced to Sandman by Neil Gaiman. And when it first started out, and when I kind of read about some of the background where, you know, Gaiman was talking to the editor at the time and being brought on board to this new thing. It was seen as kind of the place where more adult and darker books could go. But in general, comics, more mainstream comics nowadays in both Marvel and DC, tend to be going to those more adult, darker places. So I'm kind of curious what Vertigo's thought process is now on taking on books and ideas to kind of keep them unique as they have been in the past.
That's a good question. Yes, comics at large, there's a lot of darker themes out there, but Vertigo is still the place where you tell original stories with original characters. You know, they're doing great work on DC characters, but they're not their characters. So Vertigo is the place where they come and they create brand new stuff. Yes, it tends to still sort of trend darker or more adult or whatever, but they're original stories. Is that answer? Thank you.
Thanks.
Would you guys agree?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, Vertigo's still my home. You know, I go visit the DCU, but I'm Vertigo.
Well, yeah, and you guys, I mean,
amen.
I feel like we're all good friends with that stuff too, in the way that the guys I show my stuff to, like Jeff Lemire or whatever, I mean, and you know, Brian, like, I don't know, I mean, I told him, do you remember when we at C2E2 a couple of years? I mean, I ran my whole Swamp Thing you.
Yeah.
It was like 2 a.m, and he sat on a couch and listened to me ramble about this whole thing I was terrified of, and gave me advice on it. And then again, when we were at that thing in 2010, I told you Detective, I don't know if you remember,
yeah.
And you were great about telling me to go for it. But the guys, I think, at Vertigo, for me, like, you know, Brian and Jeff Lemire and the editors there, like Mark, for example, I sort of secretly run all my DCU stuff by Mark, too. You have a bond, you know, because it's where you go to do your own stuff, and you respect that a lot, I think, in each other's writing, and definitely, I feel the same way. I mean, it's where you go to sort of develop and grow.
All right, I think we got time for one more.
Hey, I just want to say I'm loving what you're doing with Harper, and I'm just curious if you're going to be doing anything incorporating more into the story or just in between the arcs.
Yeah. No, I definitely want to incorporate Harper more into the story. She's going to be actually in Detective soon as well. And so she is going to play a part in the larger Bat world as well. And, you know, she's a character that means a lot to me personally, just in terms of developing somebody who you get to see Gotham through who isn't, you know, who's down on her luck and struggling. And I always love Gotham Central to death. So it's sort of, you know, my way of being able to do something from a kind of angle like that where you see Gotham from a really, you know, human point of view. So yeah, she definitely has a lot of stories coming in a big way, not just in the little one-shots. Cool. Thanks, though.
Thanks.
Sure.
All right, Catwoman gets the last word.
My question's for Brian. I was wondering where you drew your inspiration for how you wrote the gods, like what they look like, and whether you had any say in what you wanted them to look like, or whether it was more towards the artist, I guess.
Cliff and I created the gods pretty much on our own.
Yeah,
we, you know, we broke them down to, you know, exactly what we thought their core was, and then physically kind of built them from that, you know. We've had a great time doing it with the gods, you know. There's some of them. Stripe's a character we love, you know. Hopefully she'll be around for a bit longer. I'm sick of war, man. But he's going to, you know, he's playing a pretty major part in this next arc. As are some of the other ones. Apollo, you know, they're all going to be, you know, we got new gods, we got old gods. You know, take your pick. Sure.
All right, I think we're probably running out of time now. Thanks, everybody, for participating. I'd like to thank our panelists, Mr. Mark Doyle, Mr. Brian Azzarello, and Mr. Scott Snyder.